Good afternoon, everyone. My name is John Ehret. I'm the Vice President of Strategy and Risk for RiskRecon, a master guard company. If you're not familiar with us, we play in the cyber risk ratings, cyber posture space. But I'm really pleased to be here with my friend David Severski from Cyentia. I'm going to let him introduce himself. We're going to talk to you guys today about what the headlines don't tell you about supply lines.
Thank you, John. Hey, everybody. Thank you for coming back for lunch the first day. I'm David Severski. I'm a senior risk data scientist at the Cyentia Institute. I'm really thrilled to be back here at RSA. It's been 2+ years, and we're all here again, some of us masked. Just happy to take my mask off a little bit, scratch the beard. Just because we're coming back from lunch, I had a couple cookies myself there. Might be getting a little bit of the post-afternoon doldrums there. How many of you have come to multiple supply chain talks today? 1, 2, some. Okay, great. So you actually came here for this talk. That is fantastic. Well, thank you very much. I'm thrilled to be able to share the results of the research we've been working on for several years now on supply chain attacks, the broader category of multi-party attacks there, and what that may mean for you. RiskRecon and Cyentia Institute, we partner together a lot to do practical research on things that can actually help enterprise defenders of all sorts, and so we're thrilled to be here. With that, let's get started. I will note we are doing Q&A at the end there, so if you have questions, please be thinking about them. Love to have a spirited conversation on this topic. Let's get to it. Marvelous. Disclaimer, yes, of course, RSA disclaimer. You've probably seen it several times. You'll see it several more times. Enough being said. So what is a supply chain attack? That may seem like an easy question to answer, but I think there's actually a lot of nuance to that. So if you look at something like Kaseya, oh, and by the way, I'm a cat person. I have to give you your dosage of cat memes in there, so my apologies, not sorry. If you think about something like the Kaseya VSP attack, where you had a managed service provider there that had issues on it, and then perhaps all of the downstream customers that were being managed by that firm were affected, that may be something you might think of as a supply chain attack. But there's other types of attacks as well. Again, SolarWinds being one that probably most people in this room are familiar with, where you had a piece of software, SolarWinds, that I've used for decades now, that had some security issues associated with it, and then all the users of that, even the users that didn't know they had deployments of that, were affected. So the question I will ask is, are these supply chain attacks? Hands up yes or no if you think one or more of these things are supply chain attacks. Hands up for yes, this is a supply chain attack. Okay, most people. Hands up for people that are not. Got a couple no's? Okay, so even in this crew, even in this crowd of the most seasoned professionals, because typically the folks that come here are very advanced, so congratulations, you're now all very advanced. There's some ambiguity about those terms. Whether you call them supply chain events, whether you call them trusted vendor attacks, multi-party attacks, et cetera, there. And if we are not distinct on those terms, I guarantee you the popular press, the management that you are helping defend against risk management and so forth, they have the same questions as well.
And Dave, just to add into that, coming from, I'm in the world of third-party risk. That's what I've done most of my adult life. The term supply chain always drives me nuts. I just kind of think of it like the cloud, right? Everything was the cloud when that was the buzzword, and supply chain's like the buzzword now. Just for whatever reason, they're all vendors at the end of the day. So that's my feeling. But
awesome. So because the famous XKCD problem out there, there's 12 different standards. We need to create something that unifies them. Congratulations, we now have 13 competing standards out there. We're gonna use a term that's generic and encompasses all these different things. So RiskRecon and Cyentia Institute, we have coined the term, not perhaps uniquely to us, I don't claim ownership of it, of the term ripples. So what is a ripple? A ripple is simply any event that takes place at an organization where the effects via legal relationship or other business-to-business relationship cascade to multiple firms. So Kaseya, you had a single firm that had an event, and then because of the business-to-business relationships with all their customers, all those other organizations were swept into that as well. And these can be simple one-to-one relationships, they can be one-to-many relationships, or there can be chains of events where a customer is a customer's customer. The classic example that I like to think about this, and John, you may have some other ones, would be Amazon. So when AWS has one of their rare, perhaps the past 12 months have not been so great, but when they have one of their outages there, you suddenly discover all the other services you have that depends upon AWS. John, you found some of those as well?
Yeah, no, it's something we speak about quite frequently, and that's the need for situational awareness and concentration risk. And AWS is a great example. When something does go wrong there, you suddenly find out, to David's point, who's using AWS. And it's something, when we talk about the idea of situational awareness and understanding not only who your third-party vendors are, because that's pretty easy sometimes, but really going past that and understanding the fourth, the fifth, and where the concentration lies. If you have, you know, five vendors that are all using the same fourth party, that's a big risk to you that you might not know about. So yeah, it gets ugly real quick.
Fantastic. So this is the why should you listen to us slide. So I mentioned John's with RiskRecon, I'm with the Cyentia Institute. We have partnered for four years now, I believe, on a number of reports that are free to the organization. Free to all participants out there to download on various forms of risk management and third-party risk management. We've worked together on things such as Iris 2020, Ripples Across the Risk Service. We've had two editions of this. We have the State of Third-Party Risk Management, Uncertainty Understanding. All these different reports have been focused upon this concept of what is the attack surface, what is the risk surface of organizations, and more specifically, what happens when all the controls we put into place fail, which is the topic of this conversation. I'll comment out there that our update to the risk service report, the 2022 edition, is due out next week. So I will do a single plug out there for riskrecon.com to stay abreast of when that drops. Looking forward to that one coming out. So that's the relationship that we have. What about the data? So there is no shortage of conversation about supply chain attacks and third-party risk management events that are out there. The question is, how do you actually define that, and where do you get the actual data? At Cyentia Institute, and RiskRecon subscribes to this as well, we're very big about saying, you know, anecdotes are great, show us the data. What are you actually seeing? So we actually have hard, quantifiable, verifiable information about these category of attacks and which we're using for this research and the research we're presenting here today. So we start with Xywav, formerly known as Advisen, which is a commercial provider of publicly identifiable, publicly verifiable cyber events. So these are all the types of events that affect companies. They're going back decades of events with tens of thousands of events that are in there. We use those to identify multi-party events, these ripple events, of which in this particular data set, we're working on close to 900 distinct publicly verifiable events. They're coming from public disclosure requests, newspaper requests, public filings, security, SEC filings, et cetera. We then combine this with the gracious support of RiskRecon with their information around what does the risk surface of these companies look like. They're scanning the internet multiple times a day, looking at saying what are the risk profiles, what is the risk surface of these firms. And then at Cyentia Institute, we also have a series separate from this on what we call Risk Retina, where we are doing additional data enrichment, where we have a team of researchers that are going out, taking a look at these events and doing deeper analysis to figure out what happened and actually make sure that we have the most relevant information for doing data analysis. So let's get into it and get on with the show in terms of, you know, what are the frequency of these events. So it's easy in this field to get distracted by noise in the hype cycle. Mentioned Kaseya, we mentioned SolarWinds, you might think of MageCard or other types of events there. These are the high profile things that get people's attention. The question is, how often do these really occur? What happens when it's not capturing the news cycle, when it's basically more in the background? Well, we can look at how many of these ripples are we seeing over time. In this case, we're starting from 2010 all the way through 2020. Why not 2021? Well, in our experience, it takes some time for all the public events to be disclosed from event. A company that's breached today, we may not know the full impact of that for several months. So we generally take a calendar end approach that we're looking at the end of 2020 where we have relatively good information. And so you may see here, well, at the start, well, this number is going up, 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 up to the right. And that's a bad thing. That means there's more of these events happening. But then it seems to go down, down, down. And when we first saw that, it said, well, that's either good for the organizations overall, or there's something bad with our communications, with our data collection. So far, we have seen that we think that we had a spike in 2016 for reasons that we, frankly, are a little puzzled to answer there. But we did have, we believe that this is going to stabilize out around this 50 to 60 events per year is what we're seeing so far. John, do you have anything that, does that match up with your experience?
Yeah.
Cool.
I'm a man of few words, sorry.
Few words for the ones that many. But raw frequency count isn't the only thing that matters. We're also concerned about how big are these events. And this is where we start to see things different. If you start with just counting, and counting is always a great thing. As a official data scientist, I can say counting is 90% of what we do. But beyond that, there are other things to look at in terms of how are, what is the scope of these events? So I mentioned ripples because we love the metaphor. We also have this concept of tsunamis, the really big waves. We actually have a whole report on this co-sponsored by RiskRetina, where we look at tsunami events, which are events that are multi-party in nature that are in the top 20%. So these are the extreme ones, the really big ones you hear about. And what we see here, this line is, you know, 50 companies. So that is like a typical threshold. You'll see lots of dots under here. And they're all grayed out because you don't need to spend a lot of attention on it. These are ripple events that affected three companies, five companies, et cetera there. But then you see, okay, we had a single blip with 62 companies. But then starting around 2015 and 16, we start to get these larger ones where you have 138 organizations affected, 165 organizations, and 550 organizations affected. These are huge scopes of organizations getting pulled in. This is on a log scale, by the way, so if that if you are looking at the difference between those, that's why 165 and 550 are fairly close together. So we're seeing what appears to be, and correlation is not causation, a increase in these large events. As the economy gets closer connected, as the speed increases, as supply chains get more sprawling, and right now more strained, this is an increasingly common event.
Well, and David, I think there's something to be said too for, you know, trying to get more fish in your net at once, right? And why target something where you can get 20 companies if you can really go for one big one and hit 550 and not have to work for a while. So it makes sense. I mean, all the criminals I know like to get passive income. They don't want to work for their money. So
still working on that one myself.
Yeah, me too. You and me both.
So now that we have this concept of frequency there, we've seen the number of events, we've seen the scope of these ripples as they get farther and farther out in the pond, get larger and larger, we can start to look and say, how does this differ from both a receiving and a generating side on a per industry basis? So a little term definition, what's a generator? A generator is essentially the center of a splash in your pond, the center of a ripple. This is where the first organization was affected. This is not casting blame. You know, a lot of times, you know, bad stuff happens there. But this is the first firm that experienced the issue. It's not necessarily the firm that is most well connected to others, but it is where the event actually originated to begin with. And what we see here is that our financial and business support sectors, and business support using the NAICS classification scheme is a rather strange category there, but you can think of it in terms of your credit monitoring firms as well. This is where the money is. That they account for almost 47% of all the generators of these events. So that we're saying is that if there's an event, a coin flip chance is that it's going to be with a financially organized firm. Oh, goodness. And that also matches up with the passive income concept.
Yeah, exactly. Why target the place where the money is, so.
Awesome. We can flip that around, and we see that the receivers actually don't differ all that much. Our financial sector and our business support sector have flipped around in position, but they're very close to the same absolute ranking order there. So we're seeing a lot of finance-to-finance ripple events spreading out through that money ecosystem. And we can see that a little bit more if we shift from this view of a single event to all the firms that were affected. In this chart here, which a lot going on here, there, you can look at the PDF later if you wish, or you can check out one of the Ripples reports where we go into this in more depth. But what we're looking at here is on the left-hand side, we have the number of firms that are the generators, the sources where these Ripples were detected, and the ranking of the receivers. And what we see is that most of these lines are straight, is that the relative rank order of the financial organizations are number one for generators and number one for receivers, with 215 firms on the financial side and 976, almost 1,000 firms on the receiving side. But you'll see there are some lines where that angle gets much more pronounced. So for instance, our education, which is a sector I care a lot about, having worked for education in the past, where they are maybe about middling of the pack in terms of generators, but they're much more common in terms of organizations as the receivers. So what we're seeing is that even though they don't create the source of these Ripple events, they're often the downstream recipients of the effects of this.
And if you think about going through the educational system, especially universities, colleges, and all this stuff, how heavily they rely on the financial world for loans and all the funding and everything, it makes sense that they would be easily swept into that and move up the rankings.
Indeed. So frequency, let's talk a little about losses. So now we've looked at how often do these things occur, how bad do they hurt? So we're gonna talk about dollars. So we first look at what is the relative size of these. So what we're looking at now is that what is the biggest one of these Ripple events in terms of dollars actually experienced per year? And you see that this is very super spiky. You're trundling along here around $20 million per event. And then in 2014, we see this huge spike, almost three times increase, up to 76 million, almost 77 million. And then we have the oddly named Chinese tech firms breach, which is not just me making one up. That was the popular name in the press. There were a collection of Chinese technology firms, oddly enough, that were affected in a high publicized breach, and the press gave it the boring, but I suppose appropriate name of Chinese tech firms breach. Friend Finder Network is the adult Friend Finder Network. You may remember from a few years ago there where they had substantial losses measuring $90 million. I will mention here, and I think John will back me up on this, that these are just the verifiable losses. So we take a hard look to say, are these actual hard dollar losses being recorded in a lawsuit, being recorded in a IR firm, or being recorded in like an SEC filing there? This doesn't include other forms of loss.
Yeah, especially when you think about reputational loss and things like that, the stuff that you can't quantify easily, that you don't know the business that you lost because of something because you never knew about it, so.
Yeah. Absolutely. But we can look beyond this. I actually realized I was just talking about record count. My apologies. But we can also look in terms of dollars involved here, where we are seeing now that this is even more different. We're looking at Cambridge Analytica. So this is Facebook. $500 million from losses and fines. That's still going through the court system right now. Equifax, another big one, at $250 million of losses. Huge losses being entailed here. But then we can also look about, okay, those are the extreme events, but what about just the garden variety thing? You know, in my role formerly as a practitioner and now as a researcher there, there's always the catastrophic events there, the meteor coming down, and those are certainly important to take a note of and to defend against there, but there's all the other stuff that's going on in the background, which can be a death by a thousand cuts. These are your typical malware infestations, the smaller scale things that are short of the company obliterating type of events. Well, we can look at those, compare those as well, and we can look at the balance of costs. In this case, we're looking at all the costs borne by the generators and all the costs borne by the receivers. So the sources versus the receivers. And what we're seeing here is that over half of the costs here are being borne typically by those receivers. So if you are the source of a multi-party event or a Ripple event, you are, on average, going to be responsible for half or more of those costs. Whereas a receiver, and we're talking about multiple firms, we're talking about three per receiver, tens per Ripple event, or even hundreds, they are representing only about 35% or so. That very thin slice there in the middle. Only about 2 or 3% of the population are evenly split between those.
Yeah, and something I'd really like to understand moving forward is if you start to see that balance out more, right? Because if you start to take into the account that, you know, the idea of third-party risk and supply chain risk, vendor management risk, whatever you want to call it, is becoming more and more prevalent in the industry. It's not just the financial services and the healthcare industries. It's everywhere. Are companies going to start to be held more liable, or, you know, put more responsibility? Hey, you didn't do the amount of due diligence you needed to do, not only in your third parties but your fourth parties. Are they going to start to bear some of that cost for lackadaisical vendor risk management?
I think that's very possible. Time will tell.
Yes.
So we can also compare these ripple events to what I was just mentioning previously, those more garden variety events. These are the events that are taking place only within the confines of a single company. That's not to minimize these, but they don't affect multiple organizations there. And what we see here is this, not that one. There we go. This green line represents the single party events. So these are events that happen within a single firm. They do the IR within that firm, et cetera, there. This red area represents our ripples, our multi-party events. And we see that there is over a 10-time difference in the typical amount of losses. And these are hard recorded losses. We can go back to every single one of these events and verify where these losses are recorded from there, from court filings, et cetera, there. That if you have one of these multi-party events, the typical cost is 10 times that of a other publicly discoverable event. That's a huge difference. And it gets even worse if you look at those extreme cases, those kind of meteor from the falling sky there, the 95th percentile, where the typical for a single party, $17.5 million, compared to about 22.5 times bigger, almost $400 million for those very large ones. So while a bad day for a single organization can be bad, for a bad day that affects multiple organizations is really bad.
Yeah, I mean, it goes back to what we said before about passive income, right? If you're gonna, you know, why go for the $83,000, my reading glasses on, $83,000 event if you can swing for the home run and get the $391 million?
Absolutely. So we've talked about frequency, we've talked about losses, and we've discussed how those differ from single party events and the typical versus the extreme case. Let's talk a little bit more about who's doing this, how they're doing it, and how fast it's taking place. So we're gonna look here first at a particular class. These are these very large scale events there, what we call the tsunamis again. So these are the largest of the large, the extreme events here. And we see that for these large ripple events, organizations are about 97%. So about 97% of organizations are made up in these very large scale events. And they represent about 70% of the total losses of all the ripples we've seen over time. So these large events are definitely representing a lion's share, that it's not just a death by a thousand cuts, there are a few really big fish that are taking an unfair size out of our loss pie, so to speak. We can also look at, you know, where is the source of this? Well, unsurprisingly, a lot of this is from external sources, and we're using external versus internal sources versus third-party events there. Almost all of this is from external sources, so very few of this are from, like, say, insider threat or other types of events. But we can also look at, drill down into that external site. And this is one that always surprises me. The organized criminal groups, that certainly is not a surprise. I mean, see that a lot. I'm always surprised to see state affiliated groups. I come from a slightly more cynical background there, where I've always heard about the threat about APTs. I remember when the first mandated APT report came out there, I said, well, that's great, but I'm defending a veto organization there, and if the nation states come after me, well, that's just game over. What we see here is that those state affiliated groups, and you can think of North Korea and other types of organizations there that they come to mind there, they actually represent a real threat, and they are something that typical organizations need to deal with, which is a very sobering thought in my perspective. We struggle hard enough with just standard patching. How are we going to defend against these nation states? We can look at this more broadly overall, and what we're looking at here is a subsample of the actors involved in just a three-year sample from 2019 to 2021, beginning the calendar year, where we see a little bit of a change, where we're starting to see more employee action here. A lot of times, I mentioned just previously that this we have not seen a lot of the internal malicious insider there. So what is employee actor? Well, employee actor is generally the error. So someone made a mistake. Someone published something they didn't mean to publish there. Not so much the malicious insider, though that does occur. It is much more about, oops, I meant to do something, and or I didn't mean to do something, and I pushed the wrong button, the wrong thing went out, the wrong configuration went out. We see, again, our criminal organizations and our nation states. We also see a new actor, hacktivists, where people that are motivated by a political agenda are coming into play. But we can go even further, and this is new research that we've been working on, is we're now taking all of these ripple events and we're looking at the MITRE attack framework and say, how can we actually learn this and how can we categorize this and how can we make available to you as practitioners the catalog of what techniques are actors actually employing to gain that initial threshold through the initial access all the way through the chain. We're seeing some initial results on this right now. We're looking at the 2019 to 2021 results. And what we see up there is perhaps surprising, perhaps not. It's valid accounts. So even with these large-scale events, this is garden variety security. Even in the post-COVID or still COVID world with zero trust there, attackers are going after as little as possible. They're actually able to use valid accounts to get in and compromise assets without having to go and burn 0 days.
Yeah, and I think if you listen to the news, you know, you mentioned nation states and all that, and you read the media and you have that certain, I don't call it fear-mongering, but you think that the nation states are attacking everybody and they're doing all this stuff and they have all this sophisticated stuff, but they're really, you know, the stuff that's going on is to David's point, garden variety security. Right? It's stuff that can be, it's preventable.
Preventable, but requires a lot of work.
Right, right.
As we're still seeing here, you know, valid accounts and phishing are number one and number three in terms of utilization. Well, we can also talk about how quickly are these being detected. So we just talked about how a lot of these events are the result of common controls, things that we know about there. There is a cautionary tale here in that the time for these events to be realized seems to be increasing. If we look back in the early 2012s, the teens of this decade there, we saw that the time for discovery, the time from when an event first took place, the time the last company in the event realized that they had a problem was a little over a year, about a year and a month, I believe. Yeah, just over a year. Starting around 2015 or so there, that dropped dramatically. And the time from the propagation of that ripple, from the pebble being dropped in at a generator to the last receiver being picked up, was only about 100 days. So that's a threefold decrease in the time to react. And it's getting even worse. So looking at recent years, 2018, 2019 there, the time for these ripples to actually propagate out is just a few months. So not only are we still working with legacy systems, not only are we still working with common events and common accounts being compromised there, but our time to actually detect when these things go awry is decreasing. And we're getting larger and larger number of companies swept up by it.
Yeah, it's almost like, you know, Moore's Law with the chip speed, right? It gets faster every 18 months.
Every 18 months.
We're getting faster and faster tsunamis or ripples hitting.
The waves are moving faster. We can also look at this at an industry level as well. So now we're looking at the time from discovery there, and we can say that, you know, our public administration firms, which have very strong disclosure laws, we are detecting this fairly common. So the dot in the middle is the typical range, about 27 days, and the two dots at the end are kind of the more common extremes, the 25th and 75th percentile for the the precise among you there. We're looking at, you know, typically 27 days, could be as few as two, as large as 240 there. If we look at our healthcare, another soft spot in my heart there, typically about 45 days. They also have very strong disclosure requirements through HIPAA, et cetera, as well. They're getting things out faster. If you look at our financial services there, a little bit slower, half a year there for those things to be discovered there, which is a little surprising to me from a PCI and other regulation standpoint there. All the way down to, you know, information services. Hey, a lot of us are in information services there, just slightly worse than financial.
Yeah, soft spot myself for healthcare. I worked in the blues for a long time, so I've dealt with CMS, and I know the reporting requirements are pretty stringent on a lot of stuff, so not surprising that they're towards the top.
Fun stuff. All right, so what does this all mean for you? And I'm glad we're going to have lots of time for question and answer, because I'm really looking forward to the conversation. I'm looking forward to hearing experiences from the rest of the audience as well. What does this mean for you? Well, I think first, know your customer. John, this is what you're in the business of. Can you speak a little bit of that?
Absolutely, yeah. It's, you know, I was a practitioner for 17 years in the third-party risk space before I moved over to the dark side of the vendor world. And knowing your customer, knowing what they do for you, what type of data they have, you know, all the stuff that you're working with, you need to know that whole space. We can't take the ostrich approach, I guess is the way I've coined it, of, you know, bury our head in the sand and not gain situational awareness of everything that's going on. You know what happens to the ostrich when he buries his head in the sand? The hyena or the lion comes up behind him and it doesn't end pretty. You know, and third and fourth party connections, and fifth and sixth and however far you want to unpeel that onion, it's a challenge, right? You know, David mentioned the state of third party risk report that we did, and one of the things we came out of that in talking to it is about 150-ish third party, 155 third party practitioners. 87% of people were understaffed at least at some point during the year to keep up with the flow of just traditional third party risk, right? These are the companies that have my data, these are the companies that I care about that I'm doing my assessments on. And now we're talking about expanding that view, right? Not just the third parties, but your fourth parties, your fifth parties, your sixth parties, the non-traditional third parties, the Kaseyas of the world, the Solar Winds of the world that don't have your data, but suddenly now they're a threat to you because we have this, you know, the supply chain attack. So getting a handle on that, getting that situational awareness, and understanding what that looks like for you. It's not good enough at the end of the day to just say, well, I send them a security questionnaire once a year, and that's all I care about is stick it in a drawer until the regulator comes by and asks what I've been doing, and I pull it out and show them that I had this questionnaire filled out. We need to have an ongoing understanding of what our entire supply chain looks like, right? Not just that those few companies maybe, you know, hey, I only care about my top 50 vendors, that's all I need to assess. You need to have awareness of everything that's going on in that supply chain. And not complete, like where you're gonna go do full assessments of everybody, but you need to have some idea of what's going on in your supply chain to know what happens when there's a ripple, right? Is it when a fourth party, I mentioned before, if I have one fourth party that 20 of my third parties rely on, I need to know that because it's gonna come back and it's gonna affect me. You need to know what, you know, the operational impact is and what that's gonna look like. So you really, I'm sounding like a broken drum, but you need to work on situational awareness. It's something I'm passionate about, and understanding what that entire risk landscape looks like for your organization.
Absolutely. And again, as we've said multiple times here, not all of these ripples are the same. So just as no supply chain is unique, as every supply chain is unique with the relationships that are being made together there, these ripples, when things do go bad and how they propagate, are different. You may have a typical one, again, looking at that $84,000 there, but the extreme events can be very catastrophic depending upon the size and complexity of your supply chain. But I think the promising thing is that security fundamentals do still matter. The things that are happening to these organizations that have these events are things that we do have some ability to influence. This is not a doom and gloom presentation, this is a hopeful presentation. And that, you know, if we continue to work on things such as zero trust and other sorts of mechanisms to address these common issues such as shared credentials, accounts being compromised, et cetera, as well, we have the possibility to really move the needle and have a more secure environment for ourselves and for our users. And that actually fills me with quite a bit of hope and optimism, which is in short supply within the security profession sometimes. And then just as a reminder that both internal errors, not necessarily internal malfeasance, though that does happen again, but as internal errors, these are good people that are making mistakes, and organized actors, whether that be criminal organizations or nation state actors there, are some of the dominant forms of loss there. They're extremely common out there. And so you may want to revisit your threat catalog if you have not done that recently and make sure that you have that within your threat planning. So with that, thank you very much. Thrilled to be here. I think we have plenty of time for questions there. I would love to hear experiences that you may have with these types. Have you been a victim of a multi-party event? Have you been a generator there if you care to be so bold? Or any other general questions you may have? Thank you.
She has a question.
Oh, I'm sorry. Yes.
I'm one that is trying not to be a generator, but trying to understand like what kinds of data we should track or look at to understand our customers better. Because I'm part of Red Hat, and I'm over the data security clients for RHEL. So we do that, but we're also doing some managed services now, too. What kind of things do we need to be tracking and aware of and be communicating to our customers that do consume us? You know, what are some good things that we can improve in terms of like insights and things that we can provide, even if it's to the rest of the supply chain? Do you have any good, good data to look at?
I think we have both responses to that. So I'll respond from the how do you get awareness question there. So I've served in GRC functions there, and the challenge with a lot of these supply chain attacks is you just don't know what's out there. What are the relationships there? My recommendation, if you don't already have one there, is form a very good relationship with your accounts payable and your legal offices, because they have to get paid. These things have to get paid, at least for your first party relationships. And they typically have some sort of contractual paper there. And that is not just your IT contracting organization, but your general organization there, because the information is not limited to your IT organization. It's going to be spread out amongst multiple organizations there. So that's a great source of trying to identify where you should look. As far as how you should look, Jonathan?
Yeah, and what Dave said was spot on. I've lived through that mess when you start a program and you need to figure out who do I care about and why, and what data do they have, what data do we have of theirs, all that sort of stuff. For me, it comes down to kind of building out that inherent risk framework, like understanding which data has value and okay, who's a high, who's a medium, who's a low, and those sorts of things, because you can't treat everybody as a high. You just can't be binary, yes or no, because you'll quickly get painted into a corner, right? You really kind of have to get granular, and don't be afraid to, whatever methodology you choose and say, this is how we determine the stuff that we care about, don't be afraid to change that, right? Because things change, the risk landscape changes probably in the time we've been doing this speech, right? The world changes that fast. So don't get very granular and stuck on things. To David's point, you know, talking to accounts payable and all that sort of stuff, I used to say as a practitioner, I was, you know, 33% kind of security practitioner, 33% salesman, because I had to go out and explain to the business units why I cared about all this stuff, and I was 33% detective. Because I was overturning rocks constantly and finding, you know, you flip over a rock and a bunch of worms and stuff scurry out from underneath it. That's kind of what it's like. And it's like a never-ending whack-a-mole game, pretty much.
Awesome. Quite welcome.
That might be it. Oh, one other one.
Yes, please.
As in, should you care about the, like, the, but should they be in the scope of whatever you're looking at? The companies, like you mentioned before, the companies that have your data, that sort of stuff. I think, you know, as we talk about kind of expanding that universe that we look at, the scope of your supply chain program, we do have to look at those. And, you know, we looked at some, I won't give specific numbers, but we looked at some of the organizations that, you know, that David had mentioned in the slides. And if you look at external security posture only, right? Just that, you can kind of get a good idea if somebody takes something seriously or not. And in things like SolarWinds, Kaseya, the stuff that we install on-prem or in our own personal cloud, you know, we have this idea of trust but verify in security. That's the whole reason behind third-party risk. You trust your vendor to provide a service, but you verify them to do something. When it's stuff that's installed locally or you know, in our cloud, we do a whole lot of trusting and not much verifying. And it's hard to verify. You know, Log4j is kind of an anomaly. You know, when we had customers say, who in my supply chain is affected by Log4j, the answer is yes, right? Everybody, right? But there are other things that are different, and we need to understand the companies that produce software, that produce hardware, even just from a basic sense of, you know, how seriously do they take security? So I know, are they going to have, you know, good security awareness training for their organization? Are they going to have basic password controls in place that they should have, or are they going to use just a, you know, password one, you know, that sort of stuff? So you can look at, and I just cut off for a second. You can look at the external posture of a company. You can look at things, even if you can't send them a security questionnaire, you can't get a SOC 2 from them, just to get an understanding of how seriously they might take security.
I'll just add to that one of the biggest challenges as a data scientist is getting the data. So love to be able to do analysis. And we're fortunate to be partnering with RiskRecon as well as our partnership with Xywave there. We have a great source of data, but we're always hungry for more. In terms of specifically on things like Log4j and other sorts of software supply chain attacks there, I'm very excited to see what comes out with the security bill of materials, the SBOM work that's going on there. Still, you know, even though we've been talking about it for a while, it's still fairly early days in terms of actually being able to get access to that on a sort of mass scale, but it's something we're actively working on. We also have a partnership with Veracode where we've looked at some of their component analysis as well. And so we're definitely eagerly researching more on this and hope to have more to share in the future.
I think we're good.
Well, fantastic. Well, I'll be hanging around there. Thank you very much. Enjoy the rest of your show, and thank you for coming back to RSA.